द कंप्लीट वर्क्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंद राजयोग चैप्टर 3 प्राण पार्ट 2 इन दिस यूनिवर्स देयर इज वन कंटिन्यूअस सब्सटेंस ऑन एवरी प्लेन ऑफ एग्जिस्टेंस फिजिकली दिस यूनिवर्स इज वन देयर इज नो डिफरेंस बिटवीन द सन एंड यू द साइंटिस्ट विल टेल यू इट इज ओनली अ फिक्शन टू से द कॉन्ट्ररी There is no real difference between the table and me. The table is one point in the mass of matter and I another point. Each form represents, as it were, one whirlpool in the infinite ocean of matter, of which not one is constant. Just as in a rushing stream, there may be millions of whirlpools, the water in each of which is different every moment. The water in each of which is turning around and round for a few seconds and then passing out, replaced by a fresh quantity. So the whole universe is one constantly changing mass of matter, in which all forms of existence are so many whirlpools. A mass of matter enters into one whirlpool, say a human body, stays there for a period, becomes changed and goes out into another, say an animal body this time, from which again after a few years it enters into another whirlpool called a lump of mineral. It is a constant change, not one body is constant. There is no such thing as my body or your body except in words. Of the one huge mass of matter, one point is called a moon, another a sun, another a man, another the earth, another a plant, another a mineral. Not one is constant, but everything is changing, matter eternally concreting and disintegrating. So it is with the mind. Matter is represented by the ether. When the action of prana is most subtle, this very ether, in the finer state of vibration, will represent the mind, and there it will be still one unbroken mass. If you can simply go to that subtle vibration, you will see and feel that the whole universe is composed of subtle vibrations. Sometimes certain drugs have the power to take us, while as yet in other senses, to that condition. Many of you may remember the celebrated experiment of Sir Humphrey Davy, when the laughing gas overpowered him. How, during the lecture, he remained motionless, stupefied, and after that he said that the whole universe was made up of ideas. For the time being, as it were, the gross vibrations had ceased, and only the subtle vibrations, which he called ideas, were present to him. He could only see the subtle vibrations around him. Everything had become thought. The whole universe was an ocean of thought. He and everyone else had become little thought whirlpools. Thus, even in the universe of thought, we find unity. And at last, when we get to the self, we know that self can only be one. Beyond the vibrations of the matter, it is the gross and subtle aspects. Beyond motion, there is but one. Even in the manifested motion, there is only unity. These facts can no more be denied. Modern physics has also demonstrated that the sum total of the energies in the universe is the same throughout. It has also been proved that this sum total of energy exists in two forms. It becomes potential, toned down and calmed, and next it comes out manifested as all these various forces. Again it goes back to the quiet state and again it manifests. Thus it goes on evolving and involving through eternity. The control of this prana, as before stated, is what is called pranayama. The most obvious manifestation of this prana in the human body is the motion of the lungs. If that stops, as a rule, all the other manifestations of the force in the body will immediately stop. But there are persons who can train themselves in such a manner that the body will live on even when this motion has stopped. There are some persons who can bury themselves for days and yet live without breathing. To reach the subtle, we must take the help of the grosser and so slowly travel towards the most subtle until we gain our point. Pranayama really means controlling this motion of the lungs, and this motion is associated with the breath. Not that breath is producing it, on the contrary, it is producing breath. This motion draws in the air by pump action. The prana is moving the lungs, the movement of the lungs draws in the air. So pranayama is not breathing but controlling that muscular power which moves the lungs. That muscular power which goes out through the nerves to the muscles and from them to the lungs, making them move in a certain manner, is the prana, which we have to control in the practice of pranayama. When the prana has become controlled, then we shall immediately find that all the other actions of the prana in the body will slowly come under our control. I myself have seen men who have controlled almost every muscle of the body. And why not? If I have control over certain muscles, why not over every muscle and nerve of the body? What impossibility is there? At present, the control is lost and the motion has become automatic. We cannot move our ears at will, but we know animals that can. We have not that power because we do not exercise it. This is what is called atavism. Again, we know that motion has become latent and can be brought back to manifestation. By hard work and practice, certain motions of the body which are almost dormant can be brought back under perfect control. Reasoning thus, we find that there is no impossibility, but on the other hand, every probability that each part of the body can be brought under perfect control. This the yogi does through pranayama. Perhaps some of you have read that in pranayama, when drawing in the breath, you must fill your whole body with prana. In the English translations, prana is given as breath. And you are inclined to ask how that is to be done. The fault is with the translator. Every part of the body can be filled with prana, this vital force. And when you are able to do that, you can control the whole body. All the sickness and misery felt in the body will be perfectly controlled. Not only so, you will be able to control another's body. Everything is infectious in this world, good or bad. If your body is in a certain state of tension, it will have a tendency to produce the same tension in others. If you are strong and healthy, those that live near you will also have the tendency to become strong and healthy. But if you are sick and weak, those around you will also have the tendency to become the same. In the case of one man trying to heal another, the first idea is simply transferring his own health to the other. This is the primitive sort of healing. Consciously or unconsciously, health can be transmitted. A very strong man living with a weak man will make him a little stronger, whether he knows it or not. When consciously done, it becomes quicker and better in its action. Next come those cases in which a man may not be very healthy himself, yet we know that he can bring health to another. The first man in such a case has little more control over the prana and can rouse for the time being his prana, as it were, to a certain state of vibration and transmit it to the other person. There have been cases where this process has been carried out at a distance. But in reality, there is no distance in the sense of a break. Where is the distance that has a break? Is there any break between you and the sun? Is it a continuous mass of matter? Yes, it is. The sun being one part and you another. Is there a break between one part of the river and another? Then why cannot any force travel? There is no reason against it. Cases of healing from a distance are perfectly true. The prana can be transmitted to a very great distance. But to a genuine case, there are hundreds of frogs. This process of healing is not so easy as it thought out to be. And in most ordinary cases, such healing, you will find that the healers simply take advantage of the natural healthy state of the human body. An allopath comes and treats cholera patients and gives them his medicines. The homeopath comes and gives his medicines and cures perhaps more than the allopath does, because the homeopath does not disturb his patients but allows nature to deal with them. The faith healer cures more still, because he brings to strength of his mind to bear and rouses through faith the dormant prana of the patient. There is a mistake constantly made by faith healers. They think that faith directly heals a man. But faith alone does not cover all the ground. There are diseases where the worst symptoms are that the patient never thinks that he has that disease. That tremendous faith of the patient is itself one symptom of the disease and usually indicates that he will die quickly. In such cases, the principle that faith cures does not apply. If it were faith alone that cured, these patients would also have been cured. It is by the prana that real curing comes. The pure man who has controlled the prana has the power of bringing it to a certain state of vibration which can be conveyed to others, arousing in them a similar vibration. You see that in everyday actions I am talking to you. What am I trying to do? I am, so to say, bringing my mind to a certain state of vibration, and the more I succeed in bringing it to that state, the more you will be affected by what I say. All of you know that the day I am more enthusiastic, the more you enjoy the lecture, and when I am less enthusiastic, you feel lack of interest.